Blackstone Audio presents Footsteps by R.R. Irvine. This book is read by Barry Press. To Gay Tardy, who heard the sound of footsteps behind her. Prologue. The thing stirred, coming awake after so long. In darkness it had been waiting, darkness so absolute that nothing existed but touch. Occasionally it stretched. How long had it waited? Long enough for its special kind of hunger to grow until its very presence filled the thing's brain. It sensed, it knew, that soon it would be free again, free to feed its vengeance. It reached out, its mind probing the limits of its prison. Time and again it had searched that perimeter, each time like the first, filled with the expectation of escape. Yet for all these years, it had been frustrated. But now it was different. The first tentative touch of freedom had come, like a probe to test the creature's lust. And it was ready. Soon it would begin. The thing seethed. It lashed out at the darkness. Then, as its hunger reached a new dimension, a rage overtook it, a rage that grew until the thing seemed paralyzed by it, becalmed. But the calm was a deceit. The calm was the thing's way of gathering its strength. The calm was that of a patient waiting, waiting to kill. 1. I know now that we have not found the cities of Cibola. No gold, only death. But that which must come to us all should contain within it the seed of hope, the expectation of eternal salvation. Yet, for those of us here in this barren land, there is no such hope. Our mortal souls are forfeit. Balaam, Astoreth, Mulekber, the fiends of hell, in the end, he calls their names, and they must obey. But we have unleashed that which has no name. Kevin Manuel's yawning jaw snapped shut. The stretch he'd been about to execute died a sudden death. His muddled brain cleared, and his pale blue eyes, which had been watering at the sight of yet another bequest of boring pioneer documents, blinked repeatedly. As junior man in the University of Utah's Department of Anthropology, he had been stuck with the donkey work of sorting through all such bequests. It was surprising how many people thought old documents and letters had real historic value. Mostly they were plain dull. But that hadn't stopped Manuel, who'd been plowing through a mountainous backlog for months now. He shook his head, rubbed his eyes, then reread the paragraph. True, he hadn't had the occasion to use his Spanish in some time, but he still felt certain enough of his translation to wonder if someone wasn't playing an elaborate joke on the new boy in the department. His eyes left the ornate script to study the parchment itself, which was yellowed and brittle and obviously ancient. But the legend of the seven cities of Cibola, the fabled cities of gold that had tantalized early Spanish explorers, went all the way back to the 16th century. Could this document be that old? Possibly, he decided, but unlikely. Still, he would need to consult an expert to be certain. Manuel was about to continue reading when a Charlie horse made him jump. He banged his knee on the metal tip of the desk, then had to hop around, trying to massage both knee and cramped thigh muscle at the same time. When the pain subsided, he glared at the offending desk before looking around the anthropology library for a more inviting seat. But none of the other desks were any better. None were designed to handle the bulk of an ex-linebacker. He smiled crookedly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.